Oh, there we go. That was my fault. Thank you. Good morning. I always love hearing the buzz begin to grow as I'm through in the back. I can hear you gathering, and it's just a joy to be here this morning and worshiping the Father. And for those who continue to join us online, we remember you, we love you, and we're grateful that you're keeping connected with what's going on at Bonnyrigg Parish. Now, you'll have seen on the notices, there's tons going on, but it feels like we're really picking up pace. And so hopefully you've had a chance as you gather to see the notices that have been going on the screen. A few in particular that I'd like to mention. We are starting our new Super Mondays. I am not going to tire of Super Mondays. It's terrible, but it entertains me no end. So we have some posters out and about, but we also have some flyers made up. So please do collect some flyers from the front and hand them out to people you know. Come join us for soup on Monday, 12 till 2. You get soup, a roll and a cuppa, all for £2. What a bargain. So come along to that. Other things I wanted to mention, next Sunday is a mega busy Sunday. It's the Halloween weekend, so we know that in the community there's lots going on, and we wanted to make sure that we were doing lots in the church too. So next week we have worship as normal at 10, then we've got families at 4 are going to be having a special light party. We've all seen some pretty yucky decorations around the place, and we want to really celebrate the light of Jesus at this time. So we've got a light party 4 till 5:30 in the Pitcairn Centre. And then, if you're not exhausted enough, we have a really special event. Some of you may remember we had a praise night for the whole of Midlothian where we gathered at Pennycook. And we're going to do the same again next Sunday. Instead of having the river, which we normally have in the Pitcairn Centre, we're going to have a worship time here in the church sanctuary. And we're inviting all of the local churches to come along and to join us. So it would be great to have you there. So the river will take place. The river is flowing over the road and coming into the church. So join us for that next week if you can. That's 6:30. It's going to be here. So thank you. That's great. There was a notice about a hint of Christmas. We're beginning to see adverts on the telly and hints of the nativity that awaits us. And we have at Bonnyrigg Parish been beginning to think about Christmas. We have mentioned it a few times. And we're going to do something a little bit different this year. The first Christmas I was here as minister, we weren't allowed to sing Christmas carols. I mean, can you imagine Christmas without being able to sing? It's just brutal. And as we are beginning to lose all the restrictions, the possibilities of what we can do are growing and growing. So I would like to invite Joe to come up front. Joe, as you know, joined the church a couple of weeks ago with the rest of the gang, and she has an announcement for us.
Good morning. Oh, fantastic. So that was your first audition and you all passed. I always hear when I'm leading choirs, I always hear the voice of my high school music teacher who was always saying, "Ugh, if you can say your name, you're in." So one of the things we'd love to do this year is to have as many people as possible join us for a choir. I say choir. Yes, I know. I'm so happy you're as excited as me. I say choir in the loosest possible term because it's just about people coming together and singing together and having fun. You don't need to be Pavarotti. In fact, please don't be Pavarotti because that would be really awkward for me. So if it's something you're interested in, watch this space. If it's something you're not interested in, why not? Yeah, what's wrong with you? No, I'm joking. But we're so excited at the possibility. It's for anybody from age 0 right up to age 300. You don't have to come to this church. Anybody welcome. We'll tell you lots more about it next week. And happy 63 days till the big C.
Behave yourself, Joe. Steady on. Singing is such an important part of our worship, and when we join together in song, something really special takes place. When we were told we couldn't sing because it wasn't essential to worship, I just disagree. I think it's vital as our worship. And for our nativity service, we're going to have two songs which our choir will learn over the next few weeks that will be part of our nativity service in December. So without further ado, let's get singing our first hymn together. Crown Him with Many Crowns. Let's join together in prayer, and then we'll say the Lord's Prayer, which will be on the screen. Great and wonderful God, we join today as part of the great company of your people across history to sing of your faithfulness, to celebrate your love, to acknowledge your mercy, to marvel at your awesome power. Receive our praise and accept our worship. Great and wonderful God, you have blessed us in more ways than we can begin to number. Your goodness, greater than we can ever hope to measure. Your love beyond anything we can begin to understand. And yet we know you as living reality in our hearts, as the one who gives shape and purpose to all of life. So we come to you with grateful hearts, seeking as we can to bring you all our praise. Receive our praise and accept our worship. And so, as a family gathered here in worship, we bring you all our praise and our glory. And we ask that Jesus would be exalted in this place. And united as your children, we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, DJ Club, have you had a nice October break? Yous have all been on holiday. I hope you've had a really nice time. And I wonder if you're getting ready to go back to school. I wonder if you've missed some of your school friends. I was thinking and remembering when I was at primary school. And there's certain things that you remember that even as ancient as I am, I can still remember. I can still remember I was the second tallest in the class. Do you know who the tallest in your class is? Yeah? You always know who the tallest. I remember I was the fastest girl in my class. Couldn't quite beat the boys, but I could get a pace moving if I really tried. And we remember all these different things, and we can compare ourselves to other people sometimes. We can say, who you could probably think, as I say it, you can maybe think of that person in your mind, who's the best artist? Or maybe think about who's the speediest, or I think about who's the shortest. And you can think, and we sometimes can compare ourselves with other people. Oh, I'm not as fast as them, or oh, I'm not as tall as them, or oh, I'm not as good at maths as them. And we can do these different comparisons sometimes. So I've got a quiz for you with some animals. We're going to compare some animals. And who do you think is faster? A cheetah or a rhino? Cheetah, you think cheetah? Anybody else think cheetah? Yes, anybody think rhino? Now, I think if one was running towards you, it would probably be moving at some pace. But I think cheetahs, I think you're right. Okay. Oh, this is a tricky one. Which do you think is heavier, an elephant or a whale? You think whale, what do you think? You think whale, anyone for elephant? Anyone for whale? What do you think? You're right, well done, it's a whale that is the heaviest. Okay, which animal is more intelligent? Dolphin or a goldfish? This is a tricky one. What do you think? Goldfish, you think a goldfish too? Anyone else think a goldfish? Don't. I need to clean my ears out. You're absolutely right. You said dolphin and I heard goldfish. So anyone think a goldfish? Everybody thinks it's a dolphin? Dolphins are pretty clever. You're absolutely right. Okay. Which do you think is slower? A horse or a donkey? What do you think? Donkey, you think donkey? Donkey, everyone think? Donkey. I think horses can move really fast when they're going for it. Okay, last one. Which is the cutest? A bunny or a puppy? That's really tough. Oh, do you think you're having to make some tough choices here? Who hands up for bunny? We've got a few bunnies. Yeah, it's hard to be a bunny. We do like bunnies. Hands up for puppies. Oh, quite a few for puppies. That was a really tough one. So sometimes you can compare things and it's really easy. You knew straight away that dolphins were more intelligent than goldfish. But then that one, oh, bunnies and puppies. Oh, they're both so cute. It can be hard. And today in church, we're looking at a story where there was two people and one of them was comparing himself to the other. He was saying, I'm so much better than him. And he was feeling really proud of himself because he was so much better. He was comparing himself to the other person and he thought he was a bee's knees. And the thing is, it's really easy, as we've spoken about, for us to compare ourselves to other people. But what we need to remember is that God made every single one of you completely unique, completely special, with your own set of special super skills, whether it's being kind or running fast or good at maths. You are completely unique. You are completely loved. And there's no point at all comparing yourself to anybody else, because there is nobody else but you. And we're reminded that we are completely loved and treasured by God. We're going to sing a beautiful song that speaks exactly about that love that God has, that every single one of us are special. So let's sing together, I'm Special. Well, DJ Club, you are absolutely all super special, and you're going over the road now to continue in your time together with the DJ Club. So as the DJ Club go off, I'd like to invite Sheena to come and to do our reading for us this morning.
Today's reading is in Luke chapter 18, and starting at verse 9. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Amen.
Thank you so much for that. Let's once more join in song as we sing our next hymn, The Servant King. So we continue our walk through Luke. Last week, we had the first part of this chapter, where Jesus told a story that encouraged us to be really persistent in prayer. Two great characters in the story, reminding us to keep on praying. And here we come to the next part of the chapter with another story of Jesus, another two great characters. This time, inspiring us to pray not just with persistence, but with humility. Once again, Luke is making it super clear. There is no room for misinterpretation. He lays it on thick right before the story starts. Luke says in the RSV version, he told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. He is super clear about what the message is. Now, if we are really honest, comparing ourselves to others is something that we can all find ourselves doing. Our culture almost nurtures it. You may remember a famous Two Ronnies sketch. Let's watch it together now.
I look down on him because I am upper class.
I look up to him because he is upper class. But I look down on him because he is lower class. I am middle class. I know my place. I look up to them both. But I don't look up to him as much as I look up to him. Because he has got innate breeding.
I have got innate breeding, but I have not got any money. So sometimes I look up to him.
I still look up to him. Because although I have money, I am vulgar. But I'm not as vulgar as him. So I still look down on him. I know my place. I look up to them both. But while I am poor, I am industrious, honest, and trustworthy. Had I the inclination, I could look down on them. But I don't.
We all know our place, but what do we get out of it?
I get a feeling of superiority over them.
I get a feeling of inferiority from him. But a feeling of superiority over him. I get a pain in the back of my neck.
It's not dated at all, has it? My goodness. It's really easy to measure ourselves against other people. Oh, I wish my life was more like theirs. Oh, thank goodness I'm not like them. Facebook, Instagram, social media absolutely feeds that monster where we measure our lives by other people. I read a really brilliant quote the other day. It said, comparing ourselves to others puts attention on the wrong person. Isn't that helpful? Comparing ourselves to others puts attention on the wrong person. Rather than looking at other people's lives and situations, we should be really considering ourselves, doing some self-reflection, think about how we can develop and improve our lives. Jesus, as always in his story, uses some extreme example. And so we have two strong characters today. Now, it's really easy for us to view the Pharisees as some kind of panto villain. But they actually were really genuinely trying to be faithful to God. They were trying to follow the Torah. They really did feel like they were on the right track. They were doing their best to serve God. We thought a few weeks ago about the power of gratitude. And here we see gratitude completely misused. What we see is the Pharisee displaying a gratitude which is so harsh. Thanks so much that I'm not like those awful people in society. And actually, while we're here, thanks so much that I'm not like that tax collector. Now, we took time to think through what a Samaritan meant in the culture and context of the New Testament. The Samaritans were absolutely hated by the Jews. It carried an enormous stigma, and so too with the tax collectors. They were absolutely despised. They were corrupt, they were greedy, they exploited the poor for their own gains. They were seen as completely soulless, using the Roman system for their own benefits. When we heard the passage, did you hear the desperation in the tax collector's prayer? Keeping a distance from everyone, he beats his chest, not even looking to heaven as he's crippled by such shame. Now, I don't claim to be any kind of religious expert like the Pharisee, proudly reminding God of his spiritual accolades. But I wonder what my reaction would be to hearing the prayer for mercy from this totally corrupt businessman. What if I heard a cry for mercy from somebody who was stealing from the poor to fatten their own bank balance? Or a sex trafficker kidnapping young women, feeling the shame of their acts and crying out for mercy? What would my response be in hearing that prayer? The tax collector calls out for mercy. He is completely self-aware that he is an absolute sinner. He doesn't try and excuse himself. Well, somebody has to collect the tax. It might as well be me. Oh, I didn't create the system. I just stumbled into it and now I'm trapped. This man makes no excuses. His sense of despair and need for God on full display. Jesus finishes this short story with a typical shock ending. The one that goes home justified is the tax collector. You can almost feel the sense of shock. You can hear the gasp, "What, that rotten tax collector?" But look at that Pharisee, so faithfully serving God, fasting, giving of his money, doing diligently what God has asked him to do. How on earth can the one that goes home justified be the tax collector? As I prepared for this morning, a beautiful hymn came to my mind, a hymn written by Charlotte Elliot. I read a little of her life. Charlotte spent the first 32 years of her life in Clapham. As a young woman, she was gifted as a portrait artist and a writer of humorous verse. She became a favourite in social circles, where religion was never mentioned. But then a severe sickness in 1821 removed her from all these circles and companions and led her to feel a need for a personal saviour. About this time, the Reverend Dr. Mallon of Geneva was on a visit to her father's house in Clapham. And he asked her whether she was at peace with God. She deeply resented being asked such a personal question, and she refused to answer. But a few days later, she called on the minister and apologised, saying that she wanted to cleanse her life before she became a Christian. Mallon answered, "Come just as you are." She committed her life to Jesus on that very day. Her most popular hymn was the one that came to my mind, "Just as I am." Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou biddest me to come. O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am, and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot. Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve. Because of thy promise, I believe. Lamb of God, I come, I come. Maybe this morning you felt challenged by the characters in our story. Maybe it's been the Pharisee. Maybe we've forgotten that we need a saviour. Maybe we've become secure in our own behaviour. Oh, I'm a good person. I don't do any harm to anyone else. I want to do the right thing. I help where I can. I give money. I give time. I pray day and night. I'm absolutely fine. The Pharisee is an extreme example for the sake of the story. But I don't think many of us would be able to honestly declare that we didn't have traces of the Pharisee in our thinking. Maybe today is a good opportunity to honestly come before God, not hiding in the acts that we do, the rules that we follow, but bringing ourselves before Jesus, just as we are. Or maybe the character that resonated was the tax collector. Maybe today you need reminded of the overwhelming love of God, the depths of God's mercy. Richard Rohr writes, "It is at the bottom that we find grace. For like water, grace seeks the bottom, the lowest place, and there it pulls up." How we need to be flooded by God's amazing grace. Grace is insane. It completely defies logic. It's almost impossible for us to get our human heads around. But it's what makes Jesus' statement so beautiful. "This man went home justified." That's grace. Jesus' call is for us to humble ourselves. And if we're honest, that's actually pretty scary. It's vulnerable. It's risky. But it will transform lives. And as Charlotte Elliott wrote, we can come into God's presence just as we are. Let's pray. Father, once again, we thank you for the brilliant stories that Jesus told. Father, we confess that there are times we compare ourselves to others, and we see what a fruitless activity that is. Father, thank you that you see our heart, that you love us, and that we can come to you just as we are. We pray that we would know the depth of your grace and your mercy filling our hearts and our minds through the power of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us now continue in our worship as we sing our next song together, "Give Thanks with a Grateful Heart." As we bring our thanks to God, we also bring our prayers for others. Let us join together in prayer. Loving God, we pray for this world, for all the millions of people whom you know, each one. We are blessed that we can worship in peace and in safety. We pray for Christians who are unable to meet in the warmth and safety that we do, but who might, in fear, hiding under cover. We pray for the ministers of churches where there is a great cost to following Jesus. We pray for them, for their families, and for the community of believers. Father, we pray that each Christian who meets in secret today would know your peace and your love and the power of the Holy Spirit within them. Father, we pray that you would give comfort and strength to those who try to make peace and justice, to turn the hearts and minds of those who work against them to good, not evil. In this world with so much conflict, we pray for your peace. We pray for our own leaders at this time of incredible unrest and uncertainty. Let us put our faith and our trust in you. We pray that you would appoint the right leaders who would guide us with grace and with wisdom. We pray for our community here in Bonnyrigg. We pray for Midlothian Council and all the decisions that they have to make. We pray that you would give grace and wisdom to those who are in positions of power. And we pray for the work of your church here in Bonnyrigg. We thank you for the resources you have given us. Would we use them for your glory? We pray for tomorrow's Super Monday. Would it go well? Would it be a place of welcome and of friendship and of warmth? We pray for our presbytery at this time of change. We thank you for the new presbytery clerk, Norman Smith, leading a new, bigger presbytery into the future. Thank you that his first request of the churches is one for prayer. And so we pray for him today. We thank you for him. We pray for your anointing to be upon him. We pray that you would protect him and guard him. In this new presbytery, we pray that you would fuse us together with bonds of love, purpose, and unity. Here in our own church community, we pray for all those who are struggling. May they know the comfort and the gentle touch of your love, the love that calls us by our name and says, "You are mine." Around us here are things that remind us of the people of the past who have worshipped and worked here. We remember those we love who have died. We miss them. We remember them. Even as we take comfort that they are in your care. Each one of us gathered here has our own struggles and needs. In the silence, we name the situations and the people that are on our hearts, knowing that you hear our every cry. God of light and love, you created us both joy and suffering. You came into the world as brother and saviour. You abide with us in the Holy Spirit, the Comforter. Be with us in our speaking and our thinking and our hearts and our souls, today and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us finish our time together with our closing song, "Be Thou My Vision." And so, as we leave this place, may we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.